Good morning, everybody. Y'all stand up and sing with us.
Good morning to my Cloud Springs Baptist Church family. Another beautiful day outside. Glad to see you. And glad to see that we're going to be baptizing here in just a little bit. New life. That's always exciting. So glad to have that going on here this morning. And how many of you are like me and just thank God for this warm weather? Yeah. All five of us that are rejoicing that we live in Georgia in the South in the heat. It's just been phenomenal, and everybody else is like, bring on the snow. So, it is good to be here, and God has blessed us. I'm thankful that we have a church, and do not misunderstand me. I am thankful for air conditioning just like everybody else. So, God's been good to us, right? So, don't want you to forget that we have a list of school supplies we're taking up for the back-to-school fair. The Catoosa Baptist Association does this yearly, just to be able to take up for kids that may not have all the school supplies that they need heading into the new school year. So, if you get a bulletin, there is a list of all these things, but stuff that you expect, pencils, colored pencils, markers, hand sanitizer, highlighters, etc. Get that list and bring those items in and bring them to the church by next Sunday. So if you want to collect for this, bring it to the church by next Sunday. We'll have spots in the back hallway where you can drop this these items off. And they also need workers on July 31st. That's the day of the Back to School Fair, and it's right over off of Old Mill Road. And they will need workers for that from 9 to 1. Need face painters, concession stand workers to serve food, and also supervising the games and inflatables. Now, I would say, Ed, you and I do not qualify as good workers to supervise games and inflatables. We would have a tendency to play the games and on the inflatables. So we need somebody, some responsible adult that can go supervise. But do be involved. We want to be involved in our community around us. Pastor and I were talking about this before church. We have to serve. We have to be involved in the community around us if we're going to be the arms and hands of Christ to those around us. So be sure and take part of that and bring those supplies in. We're going to go ahead and pray, and then you guys are going to lead us in some more worship time here, and we'll move on with the service. Father God, I do love you, and I thank you so much for loving me. I thank you for salvation through your Son, Jesus Christ. And God, I pray that your Holy Spirit would rest on this place this morning. I ask that every heart and mind would turn towards you and that we would hear from heaven today. And God, I ask that as we baptize, God, help us to be a church that makes disciples. We don't just want to see people be saved alone. We want that new life, but God, we want to see people that are going to grow in a relationship with you. And God, teach us how to do that better, how to be more effective in growing the ones that are going to go and multiply the gospel across the whole nation, across the whole world. God, I pray that as we move forward in this service, every part, every person and every part, that you would anoint it, that the worship time would connect our hearts to heaven, and whenever Brother Bill comes and brings the message, that the word would be sharp, and that we would go out from here changed, and that we would be different than how we came in. God, I thank you for those that are visiting here with us this morning, if this is their first time or they're just visiting with us for the first time in a long time. Thank you so much for bringing them this way, God. I pray that they would just see that we just want to love you and that we want to be in your word. And God, all that we do, I ask that you would get the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Ed and ladies, oh, I'm sorry. I messed that up. Bill's going to lead us in baptism now. Brother Bill, it's amen. Yours.
Thank you, Brother Dalton. Thank you for being here today and being a part of this service. Greg came to know the Lord Jesus Christ 2 weeks ago. And this coming Saturday, if I'm correct, he'll be getting married. Wow. What a special time. Be able to remember his wedding anniversary, to be able to remember his baptism, to be able to remember his day of salvation. You're going to have a good July. Baptism is that outward picture of an inward change. Do you have to be baptized to be saved, preacher? No, you don't. But we do it to follow Christ in obedience. If our Lord and Savior said, I want to be baptized, it's a good idea that me and you should be baptized. Just as that personal testimony. I'm excited. And I'm really trying to hold it together. Do you know why I like this so much? It tells me there's been a new birth. And how many of you parents were happy when your kids were born? Say amen. How many of you are happy when your grandkids were born? Say amen. It got a little louder, didn't it? How many of you are happy when your great-great-grandkids were born? Cool. What do you think the kingdom of heaven's doing for the last couple of weeks? Went over the announcement. We have a new birth. Gregory's been born again, saved for all eternity. I bet nobody in heaven shouted. I bet nobody worshiped. I bet nobody got excited. But my Bible tells me there's rejoicing in the presence of angels over one. Over one. Over one. If you're happy as heaven is happy that one came to know Him. Why don't you just praise the Lord with a hand clap of praise? Amen? Why don't you do that, Gregory?
I'll have you sit there, put your feet underneath that bar, and that'll keep you from sliding in yours.
That Sunday that Gregory came down, and family, friends, if y'all want to come up here to get a little closer, you can do that, whatever you need to do. If you need to stand, please do that. It's A-okay. Lisa, you know what you can do. If you need to come do it, it's fine. I'll give you time, I promise you. We take pictures at weddings. We take pictures at other opportunities. Let's take pictures when there's a baptism, okay? The Sunday he came, I motioned for one of our deacons to come down and speak with him. And Dalton came down and was kneeling beside him, and I noticed Dalton just backed off a little bit. And after it was over with, he said, "Preacher, I didn't need to tell him anything. He was telling God everything. That he was sorry for his sins and that he wanted to be saved and he wanted to be different." That's what happens when you meet the real Savior. And I'm thrilled to baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. It's a good thing to have a saved husband. You'll know this next Saturday. And y'all may not have heard it, but he was sitting here on the little platform we had. He said, "This is awesome." Some of y'all have forgot that. Some of y'all have forgot. This is awesome. You've just witnessed someone telling the world there's something different on the inside of me. I'm not the same anymore. I have been changed. And now he has a responsibility to live up to it. If you're as happy as I am, would you say amen, Brother Eddie? Y'all come and lead us on the count of three. Say amen. One, two, three.
They want us all to sing after that now. So y'all stand up. Y'all stand back up with me and sing, okay? Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart.
blessings on Pastor as he brings a message in a few minutes. We ask your blessings, Lord, on the offering that we're about to take and all that's about to take place. Help us to see more people come to know you and come into the kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right, fellas, if you'll come on down, we're going to take up our morning tithes and offerings. And don't forget, if you are not visiting with us and you still would like to tithe, you can do that either online through the website or through the app. And we're going to take this up and go on through the other service.
Thank you so very much. I'm going to have to take a break just a minute. Is that okay with y'all? Take a break for a minute. Come on, give me a hug. Come on. All right. I love you. All right. She wanted to give me a hug, and I ain't going to keep her from it. Any of your other children want to hug me, you feel free to. And thank you, Children's Church. You got this on TV? His address is... I love you too. Children's Church this morning, Brother Eddie? Children's Church. Children, you're dismissed at this time. Head on up to Children's Church. Have a wonderful, wonderful time up there, guys. Thank you so much for being here, and appreciate the singing this morning. We've done a lot of business. Gregory, thank you for allowing me to baptize you. Brother Jack, thank you for donating a new Bible to our new believer in the Lord, and I really appreciate that so very much. Alma, I will get all the information you need. I promise you that. You all wrote down stuff. So, well, what a Sunday. I took a few days off, and we had spent a little time down at the ocean, and so we had a good time there, and drove back 12 hours on a 6.5-hour trip. Traffic everywhere we went, every place we was, and so tense driving all yesterday afternoon, but looking forward to being here today, being with you, our family, and we love our family, and we appreciate you so very, very much, and it means a lot to us. You that are visiting with us, thank you for being here, and we're honored to have you, and if we know your first name, we've shook hands with you, you're part of our crowd here at Cloud Springs now, so you don't have to feel like you're a stranger among anybody. You're among family and friends. I'm going to start out asking a single question, as I have been for the last few weeks, and I will do it again today. I'm going to ask you to respond to the Word of God today. I'm going to ask you to respond. And someone challenged me a little bit a few weeks ago, and not in a negative way. They said, "Preacher, why did you say we need to respond?" Well, guess what? If you sit and hear anyone speak, if you sit and hear anyone sing, you respond one way or the other. How many of you have ever responded like this? Oh, bless his heart. Has anybody ever done that? Has anybody ever said, "Well, bless her heart"? You responded, didn't you? You responded in a way that may not have been positive. Some of you will respond by coming down to an altar. Some of you will bow your heads where you're at, and that's quite all right. Others of you, I'm asking you to respond to a lifestyle change. Do what you're supposed to do and be a part of what God has called you to do, and it'll make a difference for the world. So I need you to understand that today you're going to respond, whether you do positively or negatively, you will respond. So my question to you today is simply this: how will you respond to God's Word? Now, you're not responding to a preacher. You're not responding to a church. You're responding to the God of the universe who created all things. And so you must understand that any time you attend a church service, any day that you wake up, y'all catch that? Any day that you wake up, any day that you breathe, you need to respond to God. You don't have an option about that. It is mandatory, if you will. So we find in Genesis chapter 46, starting with verses 1 through 3, and today's sermon is simply this: real trust. Real trust. The story starts out, it says in verse number 1, chapter 46 of Genesis, "So Israel set out with all that he had and came to Beersheba, and offered sacrifices to the God of his father Isaac. And God spoke to Israel in a vision of the night and said, 'Jacob, Jacob.' And he said, 'Here I am.' Then he said, 'I am God, the God of your fathers. Do not be afraid to go down to Egypt, for I will make you into a great nation there.'" A following verse that you need to pin to the side, to the left or right of wherever you're writing, is Romans 8:28. That verse simply says this, and I didn't give it to Charlie, but it simply says this: "And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose." Today, I want to deal with an issue that a lot of us have, and sometimes we let it rule our lives. You that are watching us by internet, thank you so much for being with us today. It may be later in the day. You may be watching us live right now on Facebook, YouTube, and all those other wonderful things that we can use. I challenge you to get your Bible out, a notebook, and a piece of paper, a pen, and write down, take some notes. Because too many of us today are living in what's called fear. Has anybody ever been afraid? Has anybody ever been fearful of something in your life? We all understand that fear is a real part of life, and it's something we can deal with. Some of us are afraid of our past. Some of us are afraid of our present. Some of us need to be afraid of our future. We need to understand that we're in a moving process. We're always changing. We're always evolving as humans. We really are. You say, "Preacher, I don't like that word, evolving." Well, guess what? If you're not evolving, you're dying. Not really. You're dead. So understand, you're changing. How many of you know you're growing older every minute you sit here? Some of you are fearful of that. I can tell you're very afraid of growing older. Guess what? If you're not growing older, you're dead. This week we went to St. Augustine, the oldest city in our nation, and we went to the Fountain of Youth, and we got us a cup, and I thought, I don't want just a cup. I want to take a shower in it, a bath. I want to waller in it for a while and stay as young as I can. James, I put my little cup under this little fountain that was flowing out the water from the Fountain of Youth, and I tasted it, and I drank that little bitty bit of the Fountain of Youth, and I put my cup in the garbage can, and I said, "Now, I understand why it's called the Fountain of Youth. If you drink 8 ounces of this, you will die immediately and you will never age another day." I was afraid to take another drink. One of my grandbabies said, "What's wrong with the water?" I said, "It's Florida. That's all there is to it. It's just Florida." You see, fear kept me from drinking 8 ounces. I wouldn't be here today. Fear keeps us from doing a lot of things. Matter of fact, if we're too afraid, we don't like to speak in front of a group. How many of you have that fear? I don't want to speak in front of a large group or many people. Yet,
We can do this. Some of you can't speak correctly. If you're among three or four friends, you get anxious and you don't know how to pronounce or put it out. Again and again, as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, we're instructed not to fear. And yet fear is so much a part of our life. Now understand, there's good fear and there's bad fear. The good fear is that we fear God. That's the beginning of wisdom. Do you understand? I fear Him, but not a fear that I am afraid of Him, but a fear of respect. I know who He is. We need that. How many of you want a word this morning? Anybody want a word? I point at you and you say anything? Okay, then everybody say amen every time a truth is mentioned. Fear is the beginning of wisdom when you fear God. Amen. That's the way we do it, okay? So there's no need for the Bible to tell us over and over again not to be afraid unless that's a part of our lives. Let me give you a few fears right quickly. It's called phobias. Anybody got a phobia? Don't raise your hand. I'm afraid I might find out something about you I don't need to know. Amen? Some of you will get that when you go home, okay? There's a phobia called mysophobia. What do you think that's about? It's about dirt. Afraid of dirt. Boy, I tell you what, when I was growing up, I had no fear of dirt. Amen? Sunday clothes or not, I had no fear of going out in a white shirt. And why my mother bought me a white pair of pants, I will never understand. I went outside right quickly and got in as much dirt as I can. There's a fear of death. There's a fear of being buried alive. There's a fear of the number 13. A lot of hotels and motels will not have a 13th floor. There's xenophobia, the fear of strangers. There's pathophobia, the fear of germs. Here's one. Ergophobia. You know what that is? The fear of work. We've got a whole nation of that, amen? The fear of work. Phobias, phobias. There's a phobia of a phobia. It's called photophobia. It's afraid of being afraid. And we're paying doctors good money to tell us we're afraid of being afraid. I found one more. It's kind of funny. I found this one. It's called attendophobia. It's people who are afraid to attend church services anymore because something happened 16 months ago and they will not come again because they're afraid. Okay, I made that one up. I made that one up. How many of you knew I made that one up? Well, the Bible does tell me that the beginning of wisdom is to fear God. So we tell our children to fear strangers, to be weary of snakes, be careful who they choose. How many of you ever corrected your child? Anybody? It's a type of fear. What do you tell them? You remember that last whipping I gave you? I will give you another. Or you fear them with time out. Or you fear them with, I will take away this privilege. You use fear. And fear can be healthy. And it can be what motivates us to do what's right. But then there's a fear that motivates us to do nothing. There's a fear that robs us of our joy. And robs us of our peace with God. And robs us of our ability to do what God wants us to do. We must not walk in fear in such a way that we cannot and will not please God. You see, fear keeps us from our fullest potential of life. How many of you know how to swim? Would you raise your hand? How many of you know I do not know how to swim? I cannot swim. I sink real well. Matter of fact, if that baptism pool was over 6 foot tall, we wouldn't have any baptisms. I cannot swim. I cannot. There is a fear within me of not knowing how to swim. We never was around water when I was growing up. We didn't go to the water. We didn't do any of that. And yet I will get in the ocean up to my neck at times and let the waves wash over me. How many of you know that I'm weighing the balance? There's going to be other people who can rescue me even if I get carried out to sea. Katie was a very young lady. Just a child, and a riptide had carried her out, and she was on a float. There was other girls with her, And here I am running as far as I can on sand dunes underneath the water. And I'm trying to get to her, and it's carrying her out. And my last thought was this: I don't care if I die, I'm going to get to my baby. Thank God there's other people around me who knew how to swim and knew how to run faster than this fat boy did, and went out there and got her and drug her in. I love what she said to us at the end of it. She said, "That guy kept telling me to hold on. What did he think I was going to do?" She wasn't afraid. She had a floating device. She was not afraid. She was not going to fear. She knew that somehow she would be rescued. Some of you sitting here today, you're so afraid that you're going to do something wrong that you don't do anything for God at all. Fear has gripped you. So, number one, let's look at this, the oppression of fear. Fear is widespread in society today. We have people that are afraid of everything. Can you imagine being Adam or Eve in the Garden of Eden before sin? Can you imagine it? Now listen to me. In the cool of the day, in the book of Genesis, it said that God came and walked in the garden. And Adam walked beside him. And Eve walked beside him. They had fellowship with God in the Garden of Eden. Can I explain a few things to you? Number one, they did not have no clothing on at all. But they were in innocence. There was no sin. There was no sin at all. It was freedom. How many of you understand this statement I'm about to make? Dalton loves warm weather, but you cannot take off enough clothes and be decent and be cool. Now, wintertime, you can put on enough to stay warm, amen? But you cannot take off enough clothes to be decent and to be cool. But understand, they walked with God in the beauty of what God had created in the garden, and they were not afraid. But then the day comes that Eve is tempted, and she gives in to Satan. Adam chooses to follow his wife. And all of a sudden, James, they hear God walking down the pathway of the garden. I don't know if it went, or if it was just a little easy walk, I don't know. But all of a sudden, Adam, who walked with the Creator, Adam, who walked with God, Adam, who followed God, and God gave him the permission to name all the animals, to bring them into submission, the God who created it all, beauty. All of a sudden, Adam goes try to hide behind a pine tree. Can you imagine how silly that was? Can you imagine just for a second that Adam, who walked with God, who held hands with God, who was in love with God, all of a sudden thought he could get down behind a honeysuckle bush and hide from God? You see, fear keeps you from doing what you need to do. Fear keeps you from being able to work. You say, "I'm afraid of my past. I'm afraid of my present." I want you to understand something. 2 Chronicles 16:9 tells us, "For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro over the whole earth." He sees everything. How many of you grew up with a mom or dad that said, "You better not be doing anything you shouldn't do. God's watching." How many of you grew up like that? Say amen. You want to know something? Can I tell you something? Your mama was right. Your daddy was right. Your parents are right. Children, you hate that, don't you? How many of you used to be children? Do you understand now? We're all in the same boat. We've all been there before. We all thought we knew better. It looks a little foolish when we try to hide things from God. We're in here this morning, and we sit behind false smiles. We sit behind hymn books. We sit behind other things trying to tell everybody we're A-okay. But we're scared to death that somebody's going to find out about us, that somebody knows about us, somebody has seen us doing something we shouldn't do. From the moment that Adam, our federal headship, the one who started us all, guess what? If there's a person alive on earth, guess who's his great, 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 great grandparents are? Adam, Eve. We're all of the family of humanity, and we need to understand that. Fear keeps us from doing what we should do. Fear keeps us from understanding that we have a problem, and the problem is called sin. Good place to say amen. Make sure you're still with me. He said, but preacher, you need to understand I'm a pretty good person. Yeah? Okay, then why did God write Romans 3:23 specifically for you? What does it say, preacher? For all have... Wow. Y'all do me a favor. Look over that at that bunch of sinners over there. Do me another favor. Y'all look at that bunch of sinners over there. All y'all awful, amen? For we have what? All have. Okay, so we're all in the same boat. We're all in the same process. We're all in the same place. We've all sinned. There's not one of us that is better than the other. 2 weeks ago, my dear brother came and knelt before an altar and cried out to a holy God to save him. He went from sinner to saint. And some of y'all missed it. Some of y'all missed it. I'd be scared to death in this church because I don't know what's going to happen next. Amen? We had someone to be born again. The Bible teaches we're conceived in sin. We're sinners by nature. We're sinners by practice. But as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, and Gregory, I'll tell you this, as a believer in Jesus Christ, you are not to live in fear of God, but you're to live in faith of God. Listen what 1 John chapter 4, verse 18 says. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. Because why? Because fear involves punishment. About this area, about 14 days ago, you knelt and cried out to God. The fear of punishment was on your life. You were getting what you deserved. If you had died before that moment, hell would have been your home and punishment being separated from God forever. Woo! 14 days ago, fear got replaced by love. And he was able to stand up tall and strong in the love of God. He was able to come forward and said, I'll be baptized. And we baptized him this morning. Perfect love casts out fear. Quit being afraid. Quit being wore down, wore out, wore around because of fear is controlling your life. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear because fear involves punishment. And the one who fear is not perfected in love. Some of y'all need some perfection, amen? Ladies, can I ask you a question? I don't think there's a lady here got any, but does any lady around here wear makeup? Why do you buy makeup? Here's why you buy makeup. And let me be honest. You may look at yourself in the mirror and say, I don't like what I see, or I think I can highlight something better. And so you buy rouge, powder, you buy lipstick. Us guys, we buy Ajax and Comet. And nothing works for us. But how many of you would say, as I will often say, you don't need that, but if you want it, yay, do whatever you want. You don't need to do that. That's what I say. But I always hear people, I need to hide this little age spot. I need to hide this little whatever. I need to hide that. We're always trying to hide something. We're trying to hide that we're afraid of the world. We're trying to hide that we're not where we need to be. Listen what the Scripture says. There is no fear in love. Get your love part right and there'll be no fear. Perfect love casts out fear, we're told. And certainly we have perfect love from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Fear harms the body. Fear can make you weak. It can make you sick. Have you ever seen somebody worried so much they was sick all the time, they was worried they wasn't going to be sick? Amen? I told you about my grandmother, loved her dearly. I mean, I loved her preciously, but she was scared to death. She wasn't going to have something to be scared to death of before.
She had no foot pedal Singer sewing machine. Y'all know what that is, don't you? You know, you played with them when you was kids. You loved it, and you get on there and pump that thing. She could worry like this and thread that needle each and every time. Some of us are trying to live that way. There's many diseases and many problems of the brain and anxiety and other health-related issues that we are suffering through because we're in fear all the time. Harvard experts said it this way, that fear will bring on anxiety, it will bring on lightheadedness, not being nauseous, it will bring you to a physical and mental point that you will break. Being afraid. We were talking about trust this morning. We were talking about trusting in the Lord this morning. Fear not only robs us, or not only causes illness, it robs us of our energy. How many of you know that yesterday I was really aggravated coming home? 8 hours turned into 12 something. Every time I'd get up to the speed limit plus, they'd slow down. Some of y'all get that when you get home. They'd slow down, and I'd be on topping a little hill, and I'd look way down there, and there was no wreck. There was nothing wrong ahead of me, and I'd say, why don't they just get out of my way? Where were they going to go? I mean, there's three lanes here and the valley in between. I wanted them to go anywhere but where I was. And we got down to 12 miles an hour. Wasn't real spiritual at that point. My energy was being robbed from me because I was more concerned. And I was trying to do, and listen, I'm going to turn this into something spiritual, okay? I was trying to get to the pharmacy so I could get my wife's medicine. Thank you. I was trying to do something spiritual and healthy, but what really was taking place, I was aggravated because I wanted my way. How many of you know that God allowed me to be in slower traffic for a reason? In Valdosta, in Macon, in Atlanta, and we come to Atlanta and a truck and trailer are flipped over on its side. Maybe I would have been right there if it hadn't been for God putting me in a traffic jam. It's either amen or oh me. Where you at, guys? Fear. Anxiety. It's like sitting in a rocking chair. It gives you something to do, but you don't get anywhere. Most of us would rather be afraid than to be at peace. Our bodies were not designed to live in a state of fear. To live in a state of fear is to live in a place where you do not trust God with all your life. Several years ago, two doctors in England studied 15 people who had died suddenly. There was no reason for them to die. There was no cause for them to die. One had a broke leg. One had a broke finger. There was minor scrapes and bumps, but every one of them died. They took the heart out of every patient. They did a test on that heart, and they found out because of fear they died. It was called cell, and I'm not going to announce the name, but it was called certain cell death within the heart. How many of you want to stay afraid? How many of you enjoy living? Amen. God wants you to live right now. He really wants you to live. Don't misunderstand me. My bags are packed for glory, but He's got me living here today, so there's something I need to do, and I'm going to do it by the power of God. I'm ready for glory, but listen, I am planning on tomorrow. You say, well, preacher, you shouldn't do that. I'm planning on tomorrow because I'm planning on trusting God. God, whatever you bring in my tomorrows, I'll be ready for it. Whatever it is, I'll be ready for it. In other words, people died simply from fear. But let me tell you what improves your life, faith. Faith will give you a long life. Faith will make you useful. Faith will help you. Fear will hamper your growth. It hampers how you react to God. It hampers how you follow God. Listen to what Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6 says. And without faith it is impossible. Now, how many of you know what's impossible? Cannot be done. Without faith, it is impossible to please God.
For the one who comes to God must believe that he exists and that he proves to be the one who rewards those who seek him. Fault halts your testimony. Fear halts your testimony. It stops it in its tracks. Adrian Rogers said this, Brother Charlie, if you'll put up the first slide real quickly. Here's what fear is. It is false evidence appearing real. False evidence appearing real. How many of you know what this is? Can you see it? What is it? It's a knife. Now, some people say, well, oh, he's carrying a knife. He's killed somebody before. How many of you understand? You could use it like this. You could use it like this. You could throw it. I wouldn't hit one of you, I know. But anyway, you could throw it. It could be used as a weapon. But how many of you know that I mostly use it for? All right, do you got the picture, right? Fear or faith? This can sustain my life if I'm out in the woods and I have to get something to eat. It can sustain my life. I have faith in this knife to be able to do what it should do. And it does it good each and every time. I've got the scars to prove it. It cuts. Amen? How many of you know the Word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword? Do you understand? It cuts apart. It brings us to the place where we see everything in our lives. False evidence appearing real. It means, oh, it might happen. Oh, it could happen. Oh, I don't know if I should. I don't know. Let me tell you something. Anything that God has told you to do, do it. Whether anybody agrees with you or not. As long as God has said, do it, do it. So what do I do, preacher? How do I replace fear? Well, you have faith. Here's what faith is. Forsaking all, I trust Him. Preacher, the church is not going to be full again. You naysayer. My Bible still says, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. And as we begin to train and disciple and teach and hone in on these things, we begin forsaking all the ideas of the world. We begin forsaking all the other things we have trusted. We begin to come to the place where we simply trust God. So when we are acting on faith and when we are trusting in God, then God can do the greatest things in our lives. Numerous times have people been led to faith because they have seen your actions of you trusting in God. You say, preacher, are you sure about that? Absolutely, positively. Number two, real quickly. The origins of fear. How did fear enter the human equation? How did we come to the place? Well, we find out in just a few verses, didn't we? Eve sinned, Adam chose to sin and followed her, and fear became a part of our life. But let me make a statement to you, and listen to what I'm about to tell you, and listen well. Actually, once we're redeemed, it is a sin not to trust God fully in all things. Listen to what I said. Actually, once we're redeemed, it is a sin not to fully trust God. You say, preacher, show me where that is. James chapter 4, verse 17. Thank you for asking. It simply says, for the one who knows the right thing to do and does not do it, it is a sin. So how many of you think we ought to have faith in God instead of fear of the world? Amen? Faith in God means what? Forsaking all, I trust Him. So what are you going to do this morning? Since God has given us His Son, since He put Him on the cross of Calvary, raised Him on the third day, victorious over death, hell, and the grave, sending Him, brought Him back up to heaven, sitting by the right hand of the Father, one day He's going to have Him step out on a cloud, call us home to be with Him in glory. Do you think God's going to keep you in fear, or does He want you in faith? It's time we respond. It's time we act. You need to understand something. God probably has more faith in you than you have in God.
God probably has more faith in you than you have in God. He knows you. He knows what you're capable of and what you can do and what you can be. Gregory, I love you, buddy. I know in future days there'll be some discouragement try to come by. And this is going to try to remind you of who you were. Hold on. How many of you in here who are alive and breathing have a past? How many of you are proud of everything you've ever done? Hey, Gregor, stand up for me. Turn around. I want you to see all the heads that said, not me, preacher. How many of y'all got a past and you're glad nobody else knows about it? Say amen. Amen. All right, Gregory. See, all those people back here, they got a past. You can be seated. You're nervous, ain't you? You're okay. Your past has been forgiven. You're not who you were. Although you're not what He's going to make you to be yet, you're on a journey towards glory. Follow Him in everything. And when someone brings up your past, say, yes, sir, yes, ma'am, that's who I was, but that ain't who I am now. If you still are what you were, then you ain't. But you ain't what you were. You're something different. You're brand new in Christ. You know, to do right no matter what. Fear develops in us the ability to not do things. Sight. We have to see it by sight. We want to do it this way, do it that way, because we see everybody else do it. Do it by faith. Trust God. God will do some great things in you. Your faith must rest in God no matter what. No matter how. No matter when. Preacher, we read in Genesis chapter 46 about Jacob. Do you know who Jacob is? He had a son named Joseph who had some mean brothers who did not like him. And one day they were out in the field and they decide to sell Joseph into slavery. Joseph, now listen, Joseph was sold into slavery, and they went back and told Joseph's dad, Jacob, he's been killed and he's dead. They didn't like Jacob because Jacob had a dream. Joseph had a dream and told them, there's going to come a day y'all are going to bow to me. How many of you would really like a brother like that? Most of you say, jerk. But Joseph had a dream, said, I've seen this happen. And what happens a few years later is exactly that. He went to prison, sold into slavery. Potiphar's wife, the guy he worked for, Potiphar's wife, accused him of rape. He didn't do it. Went to prison, falsely went to prison. Shared what he had, the talents that God had gave him to interpret dreams. He's supposed to be remembered, but nobody remembered him. Finally, there was a day somebody did remember him, and Joseph becomes prime minister of Egypt, and guess what he's got? All the food that's needed for everybody in the entire world. Here come some little boys. Said, we're hungry, can we have something? And Joseph recognizes who they are, the very brothers that stuck him in a caravan, was sold off, who caused him to go to prison, who caused him to be whipped, who caused him to be chained, who caused him to lose everything in life. He's the prime minister right now, and he's able to look at them, and I love this. He looked at them with the heart and the eyes of God. He said, as a matter of fact, read the story. Read the story. He wept secretly. He didn't want them to know. He wept. He said, oh God, you've sent them to me. Oh God, you sent them. He wasn't saying, oh boy, he sent them to me. I'm going to put them in jail. That's not what he said. He said, can I ask you about your dad? Can you imagine just for a second, Joseph, who loved his dad and his dad loved him,
And all of a sudden he finds out that his dad's still alive. He found out he had a younger brother too, didn't know about. You read the story, you find out that Jacob, all the children come back except for one. They kept him and they said, "Jacob, we need to go up here. You're not going to believe what's happened." Can you understand the table, the story at the table that night? "Dad, we lied to you 40 years ago. We sold him into slavery. He's a prime minister up there now. He's got all the food we need." And can you look at old Jacob saying, "No, no, 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 no. Y'all did something mean. He's going to kill us all." You say, "Preacher, that's not how it states." Well, listen to me. In chapter 46, it said that he begins his journey. But he gets scared and he stops. What does he do? He stops and prays. And how many of you know before you eat, you ought to pray? Amen? Some of us need to pray after we eat. Amen? Joseph didn't start out right, and we don't either. There's nothing wrong with having connections. There's nothing wrong with having friends. There's nothing wrong with having an ability. There's nothing wrong with having a good foundation, a good education, a positive position. But what you really need to know is you need to have a real trust in God for your life. Preacher, what do I need to do? You need to trust God. Number three, here's how you overcome fear. Get in touch with the one who's above it all. James, I love people who have answers. I really do. A dear friend of mine called us yesterday. We was traveling back home, and he's a dear friend of mine. Whenever I've got a question, a mechanical question, I'll call him, and he generally can just tell me what I need to do, when I need to do it, and how I need to do it. Generally can just say, "This is what you need to do." I'm not afraid of anything he tells me because I know that's exactly what I need to do. Some of you need to listen to God. You need to listen to God. He's trying to tell you what you need to do, and you're being afraid. You're allowing fear to take place over faith. You see, if you get in touch with the one who created it all, who owns it all, who has it all, what do you need? How many of you like to go shop at Walmart? How many of you like it because it's the one place that has everything, basically, right? That's why you like to go there. Well, they don't have everything, I'll tell you. But I know someone who has everything. Everything I need, everything I've got to have. See, some of you need to do what 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7 says, cast all your cares on Him. Cast them, throw them, give them to Him. Some of you need to realize Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15. We have a high priest that knows what it feels like, who understands our sicknesses, our diseases, our issues, who knows what it feels like to be tempted, and yet He did not sin. You need to be like Psalms chapter 27. Wait on the Lord. Trust Him. Be of good courage. Some of you need to get in touch with Him this morning. Some of you are so afraid, you just don't understand. Do you understand that fear can bring you to the right place? Martin Luther began his journey of faith in a great thunderstorm. How many of you are scared of storms? I'll tell you something. My wife's sitting right there. I loved it when we first got married. We went and stayed on an island. Jekyll Island. So not Hawaii. Jekyll Island. And the storms roll right up out of the sea. How many of you know I'm just eating that up? Lightning, wind, rain. Some of y'all are looking at me like you're crazy. Robin said, "Close the curtains." She didn't want to see the storm. I'm fascinated by it. I'd be a storm chaser. I really would. Wouldn't get far, but I'd chase it for a minute or two. Fascinated by the power and the force. Listen to what I just said. All that is for destruction. I got one who's more powerful, has more force, more ability, more knowledge, more strength, more courage, more love, more understanding than I'll ever need. and he supplies me with all of it. You need to get in touch with him. You need to get in touch with God before you're going through it. So as when you're going through it, it's okay. Martin Luther was scared in a thunderstorm and cried out to God. John Newton was in the ocean. You know his song? Guarantee you, I can sing three words of it. You'll join me. Amazing grace, how sweet. Now, isn't that amazing? He's shipwrecked. He's broken. He's battered. The ship's gone. He's floating in a dark ocean. Storms all around him. And it said in his testimony, he remembered what his mom had shared with him. His dad was a rascal. His mom was a saint. She put into him faith. Dad put into him fear. Fear will either make you stand out as a person because you turn to faith, or fear will make you a person who fails in every part of your life. For over 700 times, 700 times, the Bible tells us not to be afraid, or be of good courage, or be strong, or be courageous. 700 times. Now, how many of you know that's enough for one a day plus? All right? And you, how many of you are like me? I don't need to be told twice it's breakfast, do you? I mean, first time they say breakfast is on, I'm ready. Lunch is on, I'm ready. Dinner's on, I'm ready. I only need to be told once a day, don't fear. Don't be afraid. So, what are you going to do? You came in with fears. You came in with anxiety. You came in with all these things. What if, what if, what if? Listen, what if never works. Time to get over that. What if I can't live the Christian life? You can't, but he lives it through you. Preacher, what if I can't keep it up? You can't. He can. He does. He will. Preacher, what if I don't achieve? If you do what God tells you to do, you have achieved it. Some of the greatest testimonies, some of the most wonderful people in life, me and you will walk right past them and not even realize what they've done. What they have done to further the cause of the gospel. If Jesus stands by the collection plate and a lady throws in the least amount a person could actually have into the offering plate, and he says, she's given more than all those that gave out of their plenty. She gave out of her necessity. She had to have it, and she said, I want to go for God's work. Let me tell you, don't think anything's too small for God to use for his glory and for others to see Christ. As we bow our head and close our eyes, I ask you a question. How will you respond today? You've been living in fear. Why not live in faith? You've been living afraid, and you don't know if you can do it. You don't know if you can trust in him. Let me tell you, you can trust in God no matter what. Preacher, you don't know what I've done. Granted, but God does. Preacher, you don't understand who I am. You're right, but God does. God knows you. And God has more faith in you than you may have in him right now. Why don't you come and confess before him? Trust him in all areas of your life. Why don't you come and be different than Joseph was? Why don't you start your day out with prayer today, right now? Make things right with him. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for this chance just to stand here and speak your word for just a minute. And Father, in just a minute, I'm going to ask them to respond, to come to an old-fashioned altar. But Father, I pray that they're responding in their heart right now and begin to deal with the issues of fear. Let it be replaced by faith. I'm not going to believe in false evidence appearing real. I'm going to believe in forsaking everything or forsaking all. I trust you. So Father, help us. No one looking around. No one looking around just for a minute. And you on the internet, watch with us. You say, preacher, I need my faith increased. I need my faith encouraged. I need my life to mean something for God. Please pray for me. Will you slip that hand up and put it right back down? Will you do that right quickly? Will you do that? Thank you for that hand. Is there another? Is there another? Say, preacher, I'm not where I need to be with God, and I know it this morning. Pray for me. Pray for me. Will you slip your hand up and put it right back down? Here's my last question. Do you know Him? Do you know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? If you don't, can I invite you to come and ask Him into your heart? If you was to ask Greg, is it worth it? He'd tell you in a heartbeat. If you was to ask anybody else in this congregation, is it worth it? They'd tell you it's worth it. It's worth it. If you do not know Christ, will you be honest with yourself and honest with me and say, preacher, pray for me. Will you slip that hand up and put it right back down? That's all I ask you to do at this time. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you. In the name of Christ we pray. And we all said together, amen. Thank you so much for being here at the Cloud Springs Baptist Church. You that are watching us by internet, thank you so much. Make a comment. Send us an email. God bless each and every one of you.